to Kapow?
Kapow's great. It's a really impressive show. I think it's wonderful. The fans have been wonderful. I've taken a lot of pictures with fans. You know, it seems to be the trend here. A lot of photographs.
You're a much loved guy in the UK.
Depends who you talk to.
You know, the Avengers have just come out.
Yes.
Doing so well. Millions and millions. Breaking box office records.
It's a little movie that could.
Yes.
You know, so.
How do you feel the next step for the Avengers is? Are we going to see Avengers 2? Are we going to then see all the rest of them? Is it going to be a massive spread? Hundreds of movies?
Well, you know, we haven't announced, you know, an Avengers 2, but, you know, this has been an amazing success story for us. We expected the movie to do well. We knew it was a great movie. I don't think any of us anticipated that it would do what it's doing now. And there's been such an outpouring of love from the hardcore fans, from lapsed fans, and people that are just getting to know these characters for the first time. You know, the one thing that we're definitely working on right now is Iron Man 3, and that's moving along really, really well. The script is fantastic. It's a very unexpected story. I think fans are going to love it, especially, you know, just fans of the movies are going to love it, fans of Iron Man are going to love it. So, you know, we have our sights set on a lot of different things. It's just, you know, we haven't announced everything yet.
And there are more movies in the pipeline. I know you can't tell us the names. You told us at Kappa Joe, but you did say that there were a couple of more movies in the pipeline.
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. We're looking at, you know, we're looking at different franchises. We're looking at existing franchises. We're having a lot of deep internal conversations about, you know, we already know what our next moves are, but now, you know, what's that third level of move? So. And those things are in constant flux.
We saw.
Sorry, but
that's all right. No problem. We saw. I don't want to give away too much of a spoiler, but at the end of the movie, if you haven't seen The Avengers, go and see it, check out the end. There is a character in there, one of the biggest characters in Marvel scene, one of my favorites,
yes.
As a Silver Surfer fan, reading from such a young age.
Unexpected, I think, too.
Yes. How are we going to see the continuation of the storyline without characters like the Silver Surfer, who is with Fox at the moment?
Right. You know, first of all, that's assuming that we're going to tell that story.
True.
You know, we've managed to tell the Avengers story without Magneto and Scarlet Witch and Quick. You know, it's all a matter of it's less about being so dogmatically adherent to what happens in the comics, because you can't do that exactly the way it is in the comics, because it just won't appeal to the mainstream. But it's a matter of distilling what we do in our comics and making it work for us and making it work for the wider audience, and also making it work with the characters that we have at our disposal. There are some characters that belong to other companies and some that belong to us. We'll make it work, I promise you.
Obviously, that brings us to another point, which is the truth of movie and comic book. Now, the biggest complaints that seem to, I'm sure you get all these emails, oh, that comic book movie wasn't true, and to the comics, I was really unhappy.
Yes.
You know, one of the things that Marvel's really been credited with is actually staying very much true to the ethos of the characters, at least,
yes.
Minimum.
Yeah,
especially with Captain America. I mean, it was very, very close to the actual comic book story. How important is that going forward?
It's very important to us. That's one of the reasons why we wanted to make our own movies. We wanted to control our own franchises. I think, you know, this is something that Sam Raimi did really, really well. When you look at that first Spider-Man movie, you know, we were talking about an era in superhero movies where the goal was take them out of the spandex and put them in black leather or black armor or whatever it may be. And Sam said, no, I'm not embarrassed about the source material. This source material has lasted decades. The look has lasted decades. Let's keep it the way it is. The audience will accept it. And I think Sam proved a lot of people by doing that with Spider-Man. And it showed us a lot, too, especially me, that, you know, you still have to distill it down, because you've got decades of story and you've got stuff that may not play on the screen. And you have a mainstream audience that really wants to view this material. And some of it's just, it was strictly designed for comic fans. But I think Sam did a great job of doing that. And I think that's what we're doing as well in Marvel Studios, is we're looking at the source material, we're looking at our comics. We have deep conversations sometimes. When we look at the outlines or screenplays, we're like, will our fans, that question comes up a lot, will our fans accept this twist, this turn to the character, this one little bit that's different from the source material? And those conferences go very, very deep. And if the answer is the fan won't accept it, we will not do it. We just won't go there.
The benefits of Disney coming in, you know, there was obviously a lot of naysayers, as there always are. You get the positive and the cons.
No matter what we do.
But no matter what, that's life, unfortunately. But the truth is, Disney coming in has allowed these movies to come out,
right.
And has allowed that you guys to gross a lot of money at the box office.
Right.
What other benefits that people don't understand is Disney supporting Marvel to do?
You know, the behind the scenes, for example, we get a lot of focus group research, demographic research, stuff that we never had the wherewithal to achieve or to gather on our own. And that's great stuff when it comes to honing your product. In particular, as we're designing, you know, animation now for kids, and we're on DxD, and we've got two shows on DxD, and we're creating much more. It's great to get that research because now we're not just operating blind and saying we think kids will like this. No, you know what? We have absolute information from kids that have been interviewed by professionals, and this is what kids are looking for, and this is what they like, don't like about a Marvel character. This is what they're looking for in Marvel shows. So it enables us to really be a lot smarter about stuff that we produce for the mainstream. You know, we know what the comic book buying public likes. You know, we've talked to all those the comic fans every day. But at the end of the day, you know, I don't know what a 6 or 8 year old boy is going to want to see in a Spider-Man cartoon or you know, in an Avengers cartoon. But through Disney and the research that they do, we're able to really look into those things. So that's just a taste of some of the things that, you know, aside from the marketing muscle and the reach they have, and you know, in international waters, it makes Marvel, which is essentially, we're still a very small company when you look at how many people we have on staff. It makes us a huge company while still retaining the smallness of what is Marvel.
And having low costs in that level, I suppose.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I mean, it's, you know, we've always been a very cost-conscious, you know, company, while at the same time trying to provide the highest quality possible. And I think that's what's enabled us to survive and to come out of Chapter 11 as we did, you know, back in 2000. So it's been a great ride. And the thing is that when I look back at Marvel, you know, when I started as editor-in-chief in 2000, and our business philosophy back then, and the way that we watched our bottom line, and none has changed. It's been exactly the same philosophy. We haven't really changed, and we've still hit those marks and shoot for those goals. And it's, you know, I think
it's really become intelligent, if you like, with the demographics of how things are.
Yeah, no, this isn't
intelligent marketing, I suppose.
Yeah, you know, it's all done with a purpose, and none of these decisions, whether it's a creative decision or a business decision, none of these decisions happen in a vacuum. We have several groups of us, several committees that are responsible for several areas of Marvel, different areas of Marvel, and we all collaborate on these decisions. And we sit in a room and we hammer things out, and that's how a lot of this...
I'm sure a lot of people out there that are going to watch us aren't going to believe the complexities, actually, that you're describing, because it's quite... I don't think you get to hear that on camera too often.
No.
But they'll kill me as a fanboy if I don't ask you. Right. Three comics that you are looking forward to reading yourself.
You know, within Marvel?
Within Marvel, three.
Let's see.
It wouldn't be fair if I didn't ask you the tough questions.
Yeah,
three.
I think there's stuff coming out after AVX that I'm really, really looking forward to. Can't talk about that. AVX number
it's
five.
Good,
yes, AVX number five has a wonderful cliffhanger ending.
Great.
And I'm trying to think what else.
Did anything come on your table that's been, you know, in the last few months? It doesn't have to be like... Well, in the future,
right?
That you just, when you saw it, you were just like, "This is blinding." You know, I never expected that. I've been here for years.
I get that stuff.
I've seen it all. This was just out of my mind.
I get that stuff all the time, and it's really hard for me to decide to pick one from the other, because they're kind of like all like children.
It's like favorites. You're not allowed to say your favorites.
Yeah, you know. my thing is more just making.
Is there a moment though? Are there unexpected moments? You know, that you, even if it doesn't have to be a favorite comic per se, but a moment that you saw in a comic and you were like,
it's really hard because we plan this stuff so far ahead of time. You know, we are. In pen, we are inked in for a year and a half from now, what's going on in the Marvel Universe. 3 years from now, we're penciled in. So there's nothing that comes across my table that I'm...
3 years from now, you're penciled in?
Pretty much, yeah.
You know, 3 years?
Yes, absolutely.
Wow.
And by pencil, I mean because, you know, within that year and a half, a story may come out of a...
What about writing-wise, then? If it's 3 years pencils, how...
No. I'm talking about stories.
Right.
Right? We know the stories that we're going to tell within the next...
Oh, it's been written in three... We've got 3 years worth of stories.
We have sat at a big creative meeting, and we plotted out the next year and a half, and we are locked and loaded, and we know where we're going. And we really shouldn't deviate from that plan, because it derails too many things. Beyond that, the next year and a half, everything... When I say penciled in, I mean metaphorically saying that it's stuff that we know what we want to do, but it's always in flux, because if a great idea comes up between next year and a half, that stuff could change.
Right.
And that happens all the time. So we're very, very well planned. So there is rarely anything that comes across my desk that I don't know about.
So it's not surprises. I mean, that's an interesting point, obviously, because a lot of people probably expect, you know, CB goes out there, does a lot of the talent scouting, pulls in artists, pulls in writers, bish, bash, bosh, comes on your table, and you're like,
wow, I wasn't expecting this.
That's always the fun part, right? Is when we discover new talent, discover new artists. That's always a surprise. We're not, you know, CB will send me a link, or he'll drop a package off in my office, and I'll take a look at stuff. I'm like, wow, that guy's got it, you know. That's always the fun part.
But story-wise, I mean, this overarching, and it's really since kind of Civil War and before even, I'm going back to Avengers Assembled, really.
Right, yes.
When you've created this overarching concept of the story arc with the whole of Marvel involved.
Right, and we started we started doing these big creative summits, and that's something that Bill Gemmis started many, many, many years ago.
But you've maintained it.
Oh, yeah.
After, you know, this period in 2000, late 90s, where everything was sinking, that's really when we seem to have seen this kind of...
What's happened is that those creative summits have also evolved corporately within Marvel, where we have summits like this to discuss our licensing business, to discuss our, you know, just all parts of our business, and it's different people to get together. We have something called the Marvel Creative Committee, which is a small group of us to get together with Kevin Feige and our West Coast studio guys to discuss the ideas for the next movie, from just a pitch to an outline to the first draft of screenplays, all the way through to the design work, the casting. So that's another sort of collaborative group. But again, everything happens in a collaborative.
So if you're thinking about one day trying to take Joe's job, you got a lot of work.
Well, no, I mean, the biggest aspect of my job, I think the reason I'm able to do it is because I've always been a big collaborator. You know, I'm not somebody that sits there. In all my years at Marvel, I've only made one decision that I considered ham-fisted, where I said it's my way or the highway.
Yeah.
And that's really the no smoking rule at Marvel. That's the only one where I didn't take anybody's opinion. I said, we're stopping this.
When did that happen?
Several years ago, you know.
Really?
I just said enough with our characters smoking. I can't stand it anymore. I lost my father and my grandfather to smoking.
Understandable.
So,
it's not cool anymore. Basically, those days are gone. We know that.
Yeah, and I just didn't like seeing it. You know.
Sure.
So that's the only time I just went up and down the halls. I said, stop. We're done. You know. If you want to have a villain smoking, I don't care. You know, have him hacking and coughing, and I don't care. But I don't want our heroes doing it anymore. And believe it or not, I got flack from fans saying, I can't believe our characters can't smoke anymore. You know, get over it.
I can't tell you how thankful I am that you've spoken to us at Tool Comics. He was Joe. I'm Eddie.
Pleasure.
I'll see you again soon. Thank you.
Pleasure, man.
Thank you very much.
Yeah,
thank you, Joe. You blow my mind, by the way.
Oh.